Okay. Okay, good evening, everybody. I know it's late on a Tuesday, but I thought we'd go over cath lab tracing. And we'll start with some of the kind of tracings that you look at, and then move to showing you some of the tracings. So get ready with your answers on the chat site. So essentially, the tracing that we look at in the cath lab is you're looking at the change in pressure in that cardiac chamber or in the great vessel, and that is transmitted along your saline, typically, in a tube. That tube is connected to the transducer. So you've got the cardiac chamber, and then you have some saline, which is within a tube, that's your catheter, and that is connected up to the transducer to be able to give you a recording of the pressure within the chambers and the vessels in the heart. Now, each of these pressures is generated by a different vessel or a different chamber and therefore has a different trace. Now, the transducer then has a little diaphragm that moves a small distance whenever the pressure changes. That movement of the diaphragm is transmitted to an electronic strain gauge, and that is calibrated to the zero point on the center of the heart. Now, the reason I'm mentioning it, this is, that's why it's so important to zero your system and also to have your system right at the center of the heart. So if this is the baby, then you've got to have it right in the middle there at your zero point. You've got to have all your equipment, because if it's above or below, it will change your reading. That strain gauge then takes that pressure-induced change, makes it a voltage change. That voltage change becomes an electric signal, and that's what you see on your monitor, and that's what you record on your paper. So if you see up here this image, right, watch this image, there's a zero point determination. So basically, you have got to be at the middle of the heart in terms of where your transducers and so on are kept. Okay? So now we'll move on to the type of traces that we see. So we typically see systolic traces, diastolic traces, and you're measuring it in a continuous manner, right? It's instantaneous. And this is the difference from echo, where you're measuring it at that moment, but it's not a peak to peak because it's not instantaneous. Then when you electronically damp this signal over several cardiac cycles, you get a mean pressure. So this is essentially how we record traces in the cath lab. Now let's move on to some of the commonly seen the right heart pressure tracing. So in the right atrium, you have an A wave, a C wave, and a V wave, right? Now which wave is higher in the right atrium, the A wave or the V wave? So that's question number one for today. Which wave is higher in the right atrium? So as you know, the A wave comes after your P, right, with atrial contraction, and then your V is there, which is your filling. So I'm not going to go into all the phases of the cardiac cycle for you. So, but tell me which wave is higher in the right atrium, A wave or V wave in a normal patient? So that's right, the A wave, right? So normally in every patient and every cath lab trace, when you look at it, in the right atrium, the A wave is higher than the V wave. So if the V wave is higher, then that is clearly abnormal. So where do you get an elevated A wave more than the A wave you should get? Can you tell me some lesions? Mention two or three lesions where you get an elevated A wave. So let us say your normal A wave is 7 or 8. Here your A wave is 15, 20. So three or four lesions is you get an elevated A wave in the right atrium. So you need to designate one person from the hospital to be right there. So the one answer is CHV, TR, and TS. Okay. Tell me then, where do you get a cannon A wave? When you get huge A waves, what we call cannon A wave, in which condition? Okay, in heart block AV dissociation. Now, where do you get elevated V wave? In which lesion do you get elevated V wave? In the right atrial tracing. Now look at this trace here, right? You have the right ventricle. To always figure out whether it's an A or a V wave, you need to actually correlate with your P. Now in this case, of course, he seems to have AV dissociation. But look at your right atrial trace and look at the V wave is elevated, right? So when you see an elevated V wave, you, okay, not in tricuspid stenosis. Okay, so let's go over this. you're going to get an elevated AVA when there is something, the right atrial has to, contraction has to be very strong. When will the right, that's right, TR is the answer for elevated V-wave. Elevated E-wave is going to be whenever the right atrium has to contract against some distal obstruction. Now the distal pressure could be either tricuspid stenosis, or it could just be that the right ventricle is very thick and non-compliant, which you could have in pulmonary stenosis, pulmonary atresia, pulmonary hypertension. So any of these situations which gives you a non-compliant right ventricle, your right atrium really has to contract to push blood in, so you will get an elevated AVA. When do you get Cannon AVA? When you have AV dissociation. So the atria may be contracting when the AV valve is closed and you get these massive AVAs. Now when do you get elevated V wave? And the answer is whenever there's a volume load. Remember, your V wave is because of that extra volume going through the, it's all that flow going into the ventricle through the tricuspid valve. So wherever there's extra volume going through that tricuspid valve, such as in TR, in Epstein's anomaly with TR, or in a left ventricular to right atrial shunt, you're going to have elevated V wave. So I think for all the exam going PGs, you need to kind of stand in front of the mirror and rattle these off. Elevated E wave, A wave, tricuspid stenosis, or anything elevating RV pressure such as pulmonary stenosis, pulmonary atresia, pulmonary hypertension. Elevated V wave would be when you have tricuspid regurgitation or LV to RA shunt, anything increasing volume load on the right atrium. Elevated E-wave, A-wave, when you increase the pressure that the A-wave needs to generate. Is that clear? Everyone's okay on this? So we'll move on now to the right ventricle. Now this is a classic trace that you see in the cath lab. You have a rapid upstroke. So let me just annotate this for you. So you've got a, one second, I'm getting a color here. Okay. So you've got a rapid upstroke here. Recording. Just tell me when you're recording and then mute everybody. Okay, so this is the right ventricle. You have a rapid upstroke during isovolumic contraction. Then you get a plateau during your systolic ejection. Then you come down to near zero. So if you see, you're going down below the baseline here during your isovolumic relaxation. And then you slowly rise to your end diastolic pressure. So now if you look here in terms of how you define a ventricular trace, it's really this. So you have to get in the habit of looking at your diastole. You see this area? You see how that diastolic pressure goes up? That means this is a ventricular trace. And you will see it in an RV, you will see it in an LV, you will see it in an MPA, which is ventricularized. Right? So when you say a ventricularized PA trace, this is what you're talking about. Now, normally the peak systolic pressure in an RV should be less than about 30, end diastolic pressure is less than 8. Now, let me ask you, this is our end diastolic pressure, right, this part, because here is where is the end of diastole, and after this you get your rapid upstroke. So, EDP corresponds to what wave in the right atrium? Anyone? EDP will correspond to which wave in the right atrium? A wave or V wave or C wave? A wave, all agree with that? Yes. So the EDP will correspond to your right atrial A wave. And the importance of that is when you're trying to determine what is your end diastolic pressure, all you have to do is look at your P wave. See, look at the P wave here. Trace it down. Look at your A wave. And wherever the A wave crosses and crosses your end, your diastolic pressure is really your end diastolic pressure. Now, this is a pulmonary artery pressure trace. If you see here, you have a systole, it comes down, and then you have a systole again, right? So you have slow systolic upstroke, you have a dichrotic notch, and then you have a slow fall to end of diastole. Now, if you look at this trace, you don't have like in the ventricle, you go up, you come down below zero, you slowly rise, and you suddenly go up again. Here, if you look, you come down, you have systole, you've got your dichrotic notch right here, you come down, and again you have systole. So you don't have that slow rise in diastole. And this is the difference between your PA traces and your RV traces. It's the difference between your aortic trace and your ventricular trace. Okay, all clear on that? Now, can you normally get an RV to PA gradient? And the answer is yes. You can get a small, like a 5 millimeter gradient, which can be normal. Right? But if you get a gradient up to 10 mm, it could be seen with flow, like you have a large ASD, something, or PAPVC, something that's increasing flow across the pulmonary valve. You can actually get a gradient of up to 10 mm. But any gradient more than that is unlikely to be related to flow and would be related to some structural obstruction. Okay. Now, we'll move on to pulmonary capillary wedge pressure. So, how do we get the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure? We take a Swan catheter, go from RA to RV to PA, always inflate the Swan catheter before it's wedged. So, when the catheter is bobbing, you inflate the balloon and then go and wedge it. The reason you do this is if you inflate it once it's wedged, once it's not moving, you have a chance of rupturing the smaller arterioles and capillaries. Therefore, you always inflate it somewhere in the proximal RPLP and then go down and wedge it. And you know it's wedged when it's not moving and when you get a trace which is here, A waves and V waves. So, let me ask you, the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure is a reflection of what pressure? What pressure are you recording when you are recording? Okay, LA, anything else? Pulmonary venous, right? So it is a reflection of your pulmonary venous pressure, but there are no valves in the pulmonary circulation, right? So that pulmonary venous pressure is a reflection of the left atrial pressure, and if there's no mitral stenosis, that is a reflection of your LVEVP, right? So what you're actually recording is, remember, the pulmonary vein, but because there are no valves at all, that gives you your LA. And if a mitral valve is normal, that gives you your LVEVP. So your pulmonary capillary wedge pressure is a reflection of pulmonary vein pressure, LA pressure, and LVEVP. Now, in what situation is the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure elevated? Can you name a few lesions in which it would be elevated? Now, if you see here the tracing, you've got an A and a V. So which is the more prominent wave in the left atrium? The V wave, right? So the V wave is more prominent than the A wave. So when do they get elevated? Okay, mitral stenosis, 1. LV dysfunction, 1. Left to right shunt, yes. Pulmonary vein stenosis. So if you see, you have multiple lesions that can elevate your pulmonary capillary wedge pressure. Starting from pulmonary vein stenosis. So you can either start this way, you can start this way. Pulmonary vein stenosis. Then anything that increases left atrial pressure, such as porphyria atrium, mitral stenosis, or anomalous pulmonary venous return will not really come to pulmonary capillary wedge. So something like a left to right shunt. And then, of course, high LVEDP, which could be from LV hypertrophy or LV dysfunction. Right? Now, how do you differentiate between high EDP versus pulmonary vein stenosis? How can you make out that this patient has your pulmonary capillary wedge pressure is high, right? So how do you know that the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure, say the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure is 24, how do you know whether it's elevated because of pulmonary vein stenosis or because of the LVEDP being high? How can you differentiate these two lesions? Anyone? You can get a direct LA pressure, right? All agree on that? How would you get a direct LA pressure? Talk to PFO and measure it, right? So, let me just ask Robin if he is recording. Okay, he is. Okay. So you go. So you could either have a PFO and you put your catheter into the left atrium, or if you didn't have a PFO, you could do a septal puncture, right? And then go into the left atrium. So if you're, when you get into the left atrium, if this was pulmonary vein stenosis, which pressure would be higher, the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure or the LVEDP? Which one would be higher? The pulmonary capillary wedge. All clear on that? So if PCWP is elevated but LA pressure is normal, that means that your diagnosis is pulmonary vein stenosis. Now if PCWP, the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure, was 20, you get into the left atrium, there also the pressure is 20. Now what is the problem? So if both the LA and the pulmonary capillary wedge pressures are elevated, where is the problem? Either it's at the mitral valve or it's at the LVEDP, right? So it's either it's some portriate atom or it's the mitral stenosis or it's a high LVEDP. So that is how LA pressure will help you differentiate between all these lesions. Okay, we'll move on now to left heart pressure tracing. Okay, any questions on the right heart before we proceed? If not, let's move on to the left heart. Now in the left heart, when you come into the left atrium, right, typically the LA pressure, the mean pressure, is 6 to 10 millimeters, and it's a few, 3-4 points higher than the right atrial mean pressure, which is why your flap closes. And you typically will have, if you've got a flap, it will close and your left, because your left atrial pressure is always higher than your right atrium. Which wave is more prominent? We answered that in the left atrium, it's the V wave. So in the right atrium, it's the A wave that's more prominent. In the left atrium, it's the V wave that's more prominent. And the reason is because of all this increased pulmonary venous return coming in there. So typically, if you get in a left atrium a very prominent A wave, what will that suggest to you? What is the diagnosis? If you get a very prominent A wave, okay, so mitral stenosis, right? I notice none of you are putting MR. So like in the right atrium, tricuspid stenosis will cause an elevated A wave. In the left atrium side, mitral stenosis will cause an elevated A wave. But what about the other things? What about LVEDP? Remember we said when you have right ventricle, when you've got pulmonary stenosis, pulmonary atresia, anything increasing the right ventricular non-compliance, right, will cause, it's the same on the left side. So either elevated AVA could be from your left atrial outflow obstruction, like mitral stenosis, supravalvar ring, any of those, or any disease that impairs left ventricular compliance, yes, and causes a high LVEDP, such as AS, coarctation of the aorta, hypertrophic myopathy, could be anything that's raising your EDP, LV dysfunction, right? So remember, elevated A waves are seen when you've got high left atrial outflow obstruction like mitral stenosis or impaired left ventricular compliance. So AS, coarctation, hypertension, any of these lesions can cause an elevated A wave. All clear on that? When do you get elevated V wave? Mitral insufficiency, right? In mitral regurgitation. We said you can get elevated V waves in the right atrium in tricuspid regurgitation. And one more lesion. What was the other lesion? I'm just testing if you were listening at the beginning of the class. Which is the other lesion that can elevate the V wave in the right atrium? Apart from TR and Epstein, which also has TR. One more lesion is an LV to RA jet. Good. So left ventricular to right atrial jet can also elevate the V wave in the right atrium. In the left atrium, you typically don't have those kind of jets. So MR is what will elevate your V wave. Now let me ask you, if both the A and the V waves are elevated, which means your overall left atrial mean pressure is elevated, what can cause that? So both A has gone up, both V has gone up. Okay, could be a restrictive kind of process, right? But typically in that, again, you will get A elevation. MS, MR, okay, could be. But also remember large left to right shunts, such as a VSD, PDA, any of those which are increasing the volume over, after all, once the atrium gets that volume, it also has to pump that volume into the left ventricle. So large left to right chance LV failure can overall elevate the mean pressure of the LA. Okay, last question on the LA. If the end diastolic pressure of LV and LA are not equal, what does it suggest? MN, right? All clear on that. And here's an example. Now, watch this. And this is where you've got to start getting in the habit in the cath lab of looking at your P wave, okay, and looking at your EDP. So look here. This is your P wave somewhere here, right? Up here, I'm marking it. So when I come down here, somewhere here should be my EDP, right? In this position. Down here should be my left ventricular end diastolic pressure. Typically, the A wave should at this point cross the ventricle at this point, right? Now, if you see, it's crossed and it's much higher in this case. So the A wave, there's a big difference between your EDP, which is here, right? Can you all see with this green? And your A wave, which is here. So that difference is your gradient, which is your end diastole and A wave gradient. And this suggests mitral stenosis. That could be a supramitral membrane. It could be anything. You don't know, of course, that in the cath lab. But what you know is that this is your gradient and there's mitral stenosis. If it was at the same level, you can use your atrial trace to also pinpoint your LVEDP at the exact location to tell which is your EDP. Okay, all clear on this? Now we'll move to the left ventricular trace. Now if you see here, and I want to show you, look on your left to the RV trace. The RV goes up, little plateau and down. Look at the LV. LV is much more rectangular. It's got a longer and flatter plateau at the maximum systolic pressure. And that's how when someone will show you an angio, right? And tell you, is this RV or LV, and the pressures are the same because the patient has a VSD, you need to look at this part. Okay? So this is flat, right? Rectangular. This, the right ventricle here, is more peaked. Everybody sees that? So more peaked RV. LV trace more rectangular, longer, plateau, right? Because you've got higher pressure in the aorta. So much longer plateau at maximum systole. You've got to keep pushing out against that aortic pressure to get all this blood out, right? During LV systole. So rapid upstroke, downstroke, RV, more flat plateau, longer plateau, LV. Okay? All clear on that one? Okay, we'll move on now to the EDP. Now the LV EDP, now let's look here. Okay, look at this trace here on your right side. Okay, so when we want to look at your EDP, look at where the A wave crosses it. Does everyone see that? See, watch this right side trace. This is my EDP going up. Okay, this is my EDP. Now watch the atrium. Atrium is coming and crossing in. So right at this point, actually, where there is a crossover, right? That is your exact EDP. It's not this. It's not this point. Does everyone see that? Many times what we're doing in the cath lab is we are just saying, oh, EDP, this is the EDP, this one. But actually that is not the EDP. That is just where you're suddenly getting your contraction. Your end diastolic pressure is somewhere right here at this location. Now the problem is you don't always know that because you don't always have an atrial trace. Right? But one option, if you do have a PFO, you get an atrial trace and a simultaneous LV trace, then you can get an exact LVDP. And this is of course very useful when you've got mitral stenosis because then your A wave is going to be like this. Okay? But remember the A wave of the left atrium, where it crosses your diastolic trace of your LV, is your end diastolic pressure with true sense. Okay? So if you don't have the A wave, of course, then you're just roughly estimating somewhere right before that peak where the ventricular contraction starts. When can an EDP get elevated? As you know, in left heart, left to right shunt, heart failure, restrictive disease, in any of these situations, your EDP can be elevated. And your resultant A wave can also be elevated. In left to right shunt, in addition, you have a volume load. So your V-wave will also go up and your overall mean LA pressure and pulmonary capillary wedge pressure will go up. Okay, all clear on this? Now, this is just some traces in the ventricle. If you look here, and we're talking about damping in your system, if you're in the LV and you're getting a trace like this one on the right, that means you're overdamped. If you're getting this one on the left, it means you're underdamped, and the one in the middle is what you should get. So you need to know what is your normal LV trace, and then when you see either of the other two, then you have to flush your system, sometimes put a little bit of blood in the system so that it's not underdamped and so on. Now let's move on to an aortic trace. So you see aortic traces every day in the cath lab. So I'm going to ask you, what is A to B? Can you all see the label? What is A to B? Then you're going to tell me what is point Y and what is point B on an aortic trace. What is A to B? Anyone? A to B. What is it called? What is that? What is that? Yes. The whole aortic trace, it's not LV systolic. The whole aortic pressure is really in LV systole, blood coming out, right? So the whole, so but what is that wave called? Tidal wave, okay. What anything? Okay, what is Y? What is Y and what is Z? Z you all know, right? What is the Z? Z is this, if you have doubts. This one is the Z. This thing. What is that? This one. This thing here. This one. What is that? That is the dicrotic notch. Right? Yes. Dicrotic notch. So what is this point here? This is Y. Somewhere up here. What is that? That is actually the anacrotic notch. Okay? So that is the anacrotic. And this thing is called your, this is your anacrotic limb. Okay, so A to B is your anacrotic limb, Y is actually your anacrotic notch, here it's not very prominent, and Z is your dicrotic notch. Now the dicrotic notch is caused by closure of the aortic valve. So when the aortic valve closes, you get a, suddenly the pressure again comes back up, you get a slight upstroke at that point. The anacrotic notch, on the other hand, is when the pressure reaches the maximum, and that wave is going to now level off and start coming down, that notch, this part up there is your anacrotic notch. Okay? All clear on that? Now, typically the peak systolic pressure in the LV, right, should be the same as your ascending aorta. Correct or wrong? It can be the same or it can be 5 millimeter greater. Let me ask you, can the LV pressure ever be less than the ascending aortic pressure? Can you have an LV pressure that is less than the ascending aortic pressure? Everyone says no. So please in your cath report, I don't want to see LV 100 by 10, aorta 120 by 80. Right? It can't happen. Right? LV has to come to aorta. So in all normal situations, LV should be equal to aortic pressure or 5 millimeters higher. Right? So check your cath report. Always make sure that's the case. Now what does aortic pressure reflect? It reflects your cardiac output, as well as your systemic resistance, right? So when your systemic resistance is low, your diastolic pressure can also be very low. So coming to that, now here is a widened, what you all know will be a widened pulse pressure, right? So what is the definition? What is pulse pressure? Can you all define what is pulse pressure? Just your normal definition of pulse pressure. Okay, so difference between systolic and diastolic, it says diastolic plus 113. The simplest one, guys, see this, difference between systolic pressure and diastolic pressure. Systolic minus diastolic pressure is your pulse pressure, right? And this is the simplest and well accepted and universal definition of pulse pressure. Okay, now when we say wide, what does that mean? When we're saying that it's a wide pulse pressure, what does that mean? Okay, in adults, like say normally, yeah, so in adults they say more than 40, right? Because 120, 80, so more than 40. So more than 40 or 50 millimeters would be a white pulse pressure. Okay. Greater than, is it greater than 60 or greater than 40? I thought it's greater than 40. Some of you have said greater than 60. So just double check that answer. But either way, I mean, definitely greater than 60 is definitely white. But many will mention more than 40 when your blood pressure is supposed to be 120/80 also falls in the definition of white. And we call it abnormally white, and you know, pathologic, typically it will be more than 60. Now, can you name five cardiac causes? Don't put one by one. From each center, just put it in one row. Five cardiac causes of increased pulse pressure. Put them all in one line. I'll wait. Chocolate for the ones who get it first. Okay, let's see. How many do you have? Okay. Prakash has got five. He added a sixth. So one is, you left out one very important one though. Yes, we start with aortic regurgitation, right? So, PDA, AR, AP window, collaterals, fistulas, PDA, AP window, AR, CC fistula, truncus, ME truncus, ruptured sinus of ulcer. Well, that's right. So you got all of them, but you need to start with the common ones first, right? So start with aortic regurgitation, commonest. PDA, remember AP window because it can cause a increased pulse pressure, ruptured sinus of valsala, truncus arteriosus, systemic AV fistulae, large BT shunts is right, ME truncus is also there. So as long as you have five, now can you name a few causes of increased pulse pressure, non-cardiac causes? The non-cardiac, okay, hyperthyroid, what else? Anemia, fever, right? So anemia, thyrotoxicosis, fever, beriberi, warm shock, sepsis you mentioned. One more, Paget's disease, right? In adults. So those are all the non-cardiac causes. Causes of a narrow pulse pressure, where do you get a narrow pulse pressure? So 120 by 100, narrow pulse pressure. Okay, could be aortic stenosis and typically things like low cardiac output. Pericardial tamponade or any low cardiac output state can cause a narrow pulse pressure. Okay, all clear on that. Yes, low cardiac output state. Now we'll go over some cath lab tracings. I hope everyone's had coffee. So let's get started. First one is easy. Ascending aorta to descending aorta, what is your diagnosis? Coaptation, all agree, you have a high pressure in the ascending aorta and you can look at the trace, they are both aortic traces. So you have a 190 to 200 systolic pressure in the aorta and a 130 pressure in the descending aorta. So you have a 60 mm gradient, so this is a significant coaptation. Okay, good. So we move on to the next one. This is in the right atrium. What do you think of this trace? Normal or abnormal? What is abnormal about it? So you have a tall A wave, right? You have a prominent A wave. Your normal pressures in the right atrium should be say 8 or 10. Here it's going up to 16. So definitely you've got an A wave. Now before you say this is a cannon A wave, right? Cannon, by the way, could go up to 20, 25. Look at the trace above. Is this heart block? Look at your ECG trace, and that's why always very important in the cath lab to get in the habit of looking up here. Look at this. You've got an ECG. You see, is there a half block? No, right? There's a P wave and there's a QRS. So when you correlate this wave, this is correlating with your P. So you know that it's a prominent A wave, but when you look above, there's no half block. It's sinus rhythm. So this tells you that it's a elevated A wave, which would go along with what? Either tricuspid stenosis or Apart from tricuspid stenosis, what else? So it doesn't have to be EMS, right? It could just be a hypertrophied right ventricle, right? So this patient actually had a BPV, had a balloon pulmonary valvuloplasty, and this was the right atrial pressure. This was from a very thick right ventricle with high EDP, right? So it could be, yes, it could be from RV EMF, but that's much, you know, a rare diagnosis. More commonly, it would be from pulmonary stenosis, pulmonary atresia, something which is causing the right ventricle to become hypertrophic. Okay, all clear on that one. Now we shall move to this. What race is this? What race is it, you think? So look at the pressure, 30, 32, right? Okay, you could say, damn, tell me, but patient must be dying, right? If his pressure is 30, unless it's a newborn. So if it was a newborn, yes, he could have a 30, but say this was a 10-year-old. I tell you, this is a 10-year-old patient. Then it's more likely going to be a right ventricle. So you know that it's a ventricular trace. How do you know it's a ventricular trace? Because of this, right? You've got a slow upstroke here in diastole. Now it could be RV, it could be LV. The fact that it's got a pressure of 30, the odds are that it is a RV. But let us tell you, let me say that this catheter was actually in the LV. What diagnosis do you think the patient has? This is a 2-year-old child, asymptomatic, he is not in shock. This is a ventricular trace, catheter is in the left ventricle. Yes, so he could have TGA with intact septum. Right? That is one situation where you are going to get a low LV pressure. Otherwise, in most situations, when you have a systolic pressure of 30 or 35, it is typically going to be your right ventricle. And the how you make it out is by looking at that diastolic pressure and seeing it slowly come up. Okay, all clear on this one. What about this? What is the EDP in this patient? Seven, all agree, very good. So it's not 10, right? It's not even 9. It's 7, because as I told you, it's somewhere actually down, little below that also, down here. Let me annotate that for you. So typically here is where it's going up suddenly, and down here is typically where your EDP would be, somewhere around 7. So very important not to look at it and say, oh, this is the EDP. Ideally, again, as I said, you need your left atrial trace to be able to know for sure which one was the EDP. Okay, good. What is going on here? What race and what diagnosis can you think of? Okay, so you think it's a simultaneous LV-RV, right? Why? Because both the traces are going up in diastole. So, okay, so it's a simultaneous LV-RV with the LV pressure being high, the RV pressure being less. So, dampened LV, actually it's okay. So, typically when you get this trace, the LV pressure is probably, this is sling, this is what is called LV sling. Where you've got this very, let me just annotate that for you here, you've got this kind of swinging up. So your true LV is probably somewhere in here. One of the things you can do, put a little blood in your system so it's not, doesn't fling so much. So you've got a high LV pressure and you've got an RV of 80. So what are the lesions that would do this? Which lesions would give you an LV of, let's say, 140 and an RV of 80? So one you've said, okay, could be constrictive pericarditis, you've said. Anything more common? That's going to give you LV of, so some kind of a moderate shunt. What else? So some kind of a moderate shunt, right? So it could be a moderate VSD. It could be some pulmonary stenosis. It could be he's got a little bit of hypertension because his true pressure is really 130. So moderate VSD or just pulmonary stenosis with a little bit of hypertension. So that is what you would think of when you see an RV pressure of around 70-80. Okay. Okay, next trace. This is an RV trace. What are the possible diagnoses here? The other trace is in the femoral artery. What do you think? So there is some, avoid saying pulmonary hypertension, right? Because you don't know that from looking at this trace. So when you see a trace like this, now this is your diastole going up, this is your RV, right? This is your aorta. Why is the aortic pressure little higher than RV? It could be because this is a femoral artery trace, and a femoral artery is typically higher than your ascending aorta. So essentially what you've got here is a systemic right ventricular pressure. So what are the causes of systemic right ventricle? It could be that there's a large left to right shunt, right? Such as a large VSD or a large PDA or an AP window. That's right. It could be that there's severe pulmonary hypertension. It could be that there's severe pulmonary stenosis. It could be that this is tetralogy of fellow. So when you see this trace, all you can say is, I have a systemic right ventricular pressure. Then next you can say this could be, if there's no pulmonary stenosis, this could be from pulmonary hypertension. If there's pulmonary stenosis, it's from PS, or it could be from a large VSD, large AP window, any of those. Okay, that's clear on that. So you don't know from this trace what is the exact cause of your systemic RV. Okay, what is this trace? Okay, so this could be, this is some kind of a right atrial or left atrial, right? Now in this, which one is more prominent? A wave or V wave? A. In which atrium is A wave more prominent? Right atrium, right? So if I just showed you this trace, you could be thinking this is also right atrial trace, and that's okay. But the fact is, it is the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure, and the right atrial wave is very prominent. But the A wave is big. Look at the V wave. What do you think of the V wave? The A wave is 25. What is the V wave in this patient? What is the V wave pressure? About 22. Is that normal? So that's also abnormal. So remember, looking at this, both your waves are elevated. What does that suggest to you? What could this be? Yes. So when you see both the pressures and the mean pressure, look at the mean pressure, 17, 18, right? Look at the mean pressure. So this could be a large left to right shunt, heart failure, something that's elevating both your pressure traces and your overall mean pressure. Okay, what is this trace showing you? Okay, it's a pullback from PA to RV. Now, how did you say it was the pulmonary artery? Because this one is your pulmonary artery, right? It's going down, it's going up. And then you pull back, right? Now, and then this is definitely your RV trace here, right? So, what is the diagnosis? So, the P systolic is about 30. The RV systolic is about 50. So, there's mild pulmonary stenosis. Now, let me ask you, do you think this is at the valve level or is it in the RV body? Or could it be at both? So, it could be at the valve level, but if you see here, your first trace, look here at your MP, your PA traces, right? This is 30, this is 30, this is 30. This is 30. Now when you start going into the RV cystatus, this is definitely an RV shape, right? So this is about 42, and then you go up to 50. So there could be you've got some in the body and then again some at the valve, right? In this case it's very mild, so it could just be variation. But when you see two different levels of ventricular tracing, you've got to follow your MPA to see you could be having a component of infundibular as well as a component of valvar. Okay, so this patient has some mild pulmonary stenosis. Okay, what about this one? Of course, I've given you some clues, but they're not always right. The clues. Where do you think this is? From which to what? You think, how do you know it's RPA? Because it's set up. Why can't it be LPA? So it can be any distal branch to MPA. Why is it not into the RV? Look at the pressure. It's a pressure of 78. And always remember what they put up here on top may not always be accurate because the person doing it may not have realized. So are you sure this is an MPA trace? How did you get a pressure of 80? What is the diagnosis? So this is 30 and this is about 75. So you've got a 45 mm gradient. Where is the gradient? Why is this not a right ventricle? That is post-tap. That you can't say on this necessarily, right? Except why did you say that? Why did you say this, tap? Because of the diastolic pressure being low, all you can say is that there may be some pulmonary regurgitation. So branch PA stenosis. Now the reason this is not an RV, even though the systolic pressure is 70, is it's going up, it's coming down, it's going up. You're not seeing an end diastolic pressure rise, right? So it's very important to look at your trace. And when you don't see that, this is definitely an MPA, or this could be a distal, this could be the proximal RPA. This could be the distal RPA. You don't know. All you know is there's some stenosis in the pulmonary artery system, either between RPA, LPA and NPA, or between distal RPA and proximal LPA. But both of these are definitely pulmonary artery tracing. You've got the aortic trace above, so you can see the difference in pressure. And you do have a somewhat wide pulse pressure in your PA. So you also have to think that there could be some pulmonary regurgitation along with it. Okay. Which trace is this? LV, right? So I want you all just viewing it. You know that it's rectangular shaped. This is LV. This is not RV. You cannot do that based on pressure, right? As I showed you, you can have an LV pressure of 35 in a PGA, right? So you have to look at your trace. Of course, there probably you won't have such a plateau because the pressures are lower. Oops. Now this. What is this trace? This is about 220 here. Aha, so I caught you now. How do you say LV to aorta? Everyone saying LV to aorta. How is that an LV? Just because it's a high pressure doesn't mean it's an LV. You need to remember that. Okay, look at the diastolic trace. What is going on here? It goes down, it goes up. Do you see it going like this? If it was an LV, what should happen? It should come down and go up slowly and then go up. So is this trace an LV trace, this one? Now you're saying supravalvar AS. Okay, so what you have to say when you see a trace like this is that this is an aortic trace. This is not an LV trace. Okay. This is what? This is also an aortic trace. Okay. Now, of course, it could be PA to PA. I don't know. But this is a very high pressure. So, we are assuming it's aorta. This is also aorta. So, what are the lesions that will give that? One could be supravalvar aortic stenosis. Right. Second could be coarctation of the aorta. Okay. It could be abdominal coarctation like in Takayasu. So all you can say when you see a trace like this is that this trace is aorta to aorta, right? So your the thing that you have to get used to, when you see a pressure of 240, it's not the LV. Remember this. When you see a pressure of 240, it's not the LV. It could be an RV. It could be an ascending aorta. It could be a transverse arch or a descending aorta with tachyanchu. So look at your diastolic pressure. This most important part of your trade. Just get in the habit now tomorrow when you're in the cath lab, every case, even if someone's telling you, hey, you're in the aorta, look at that pressure. When they're telling you you're in the ventricle, look at that pressure. Sometimes, and that's why I don't always look at what they've annotated above. But sometimes you think you're in the LV, but you're not, because he has supravalvar AS or something and you get a very high pressure. Yes, supravalvar AS with PS, and you've not crossed into the LV, you will make out by looking at your diastolic pressure. So this patient, if the aortic to aortic gradient could be from supravalvar AS, could be from coarctation, tachyasu, could be from any of those. Okay, all clear on that? This one. Diagnosis. What happened? Everyone getting sleepy? We'll stop very shortly. So, okay. You see, you can't give an exact diagnosis necessarily. All you can say that's right is it's a white pulse pressure. Right? Why is this not a left ventricle? It's not a left ventricle for sure. Again, look at that diastolic. Diastolic coming down and then your rapid upstroke. Diastolic coming down, rapid upstroke. So, this is not a left ventricle. If this is in the aorta, you have got a systolic pressure of 180. And a diastolic pressure of 50, you've got a very wide pulse pressure, and it could be AR, it could be your PDA, it could be any of the lesions that we discussed. Okay, but again, important thing is to make out that this is not an LV trace. Just because it's 180 there and a very low pressure down here doesn't mean it's LV. Look at the actual pressure, because you will never have an LV EDP of 60 or 70. Right? That just can't happen. Even if you have AR, and you have or some LV dysfunction, your EDP may go up to 20-25. It's not going to go to 60. Second, look at that diastolic trace. And with that, we come to the end of this session on cath lab tracing. We'll follow it up next with some with angiograms and views and so on. So we go over everything from basics to beyond. Thank you. Robin, stop recording. Okay, all clear on that, guys? This will also be on the e-teaching portal. If you guys promise to do all the quizzes, then I'm happy to make it into a quiz and put it up there. Since no one's been attempting the quizzes that are there, we've stopped putting the quizzes up. But there are currently 9 quizzes on the portal from a few months ago. So if you can all attempt the quizzes, we get actually the answers. You can watch the video and attempt the quiz. If I see that that's happening actively, we'll put more of these quizzes on. Okay? Okay, thank you guys. Yeah, Prakash, I'll be at CAT conference tomorrow.